بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وصل على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين وصل على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين وصل على صحبه أجمعين وصل على أزواجه وصل على التابعين وصل اللهم على جميع المسلمين وصل يا ربنا علينا معهم بمنك وفضلك وجودك يا أكرم الأكرمين إلى يوم الدين. Jazakumullahu khairan here for coming. So inshallah we have with us brother and Imam Zijad. I've known Imam Zijad when I was in Richmond since I was a kid. And brother Yusuf apparently have known him as well. And then he went to Ottawa. He right now is one of the imams in Ottawa, and I will let him introduce himself, but he has a lot of background in Sharia from different cities. And he just asked me to make it brief and he will introduce himself inshallah. So without further ado, Imam Zijad.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah. Salatu wassalamu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nas'aluhu al-karamata fima ba'da al-maut lana wa li jami'i al-mu'minin wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وبعد قال الله تعالى عز وجل في الكتاب الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنذر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون ولا تكونوا كالذين نسوا الله فأنساهم أنفسهم أولئك هم الفاسقون. We praise our Creator, Rabbana. We seek protection with Him from any kind of evil that would come into our minds, our hearts, our actions, and we state there is no God but Allah and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the Messenger of Allah. A privilege to be again with you. I have been regular to Victoria when I was living in Vancouver. I served as an imam, the longest serving imam in Richmond Masjid, 11 years in total. And alhamdulillah, you know, I got quite an experience because that masjid is very central, but is also central with many of challenges that an imam could face. I was born in Bosnia, and then from Bosnia I went to Pakistan and I got my BA in International Islamic University, stayed there for 4 years, and then inshallah from there I went back to Bosnia. I worked as a head imam, mufti of the central region until aggression on Bosnia in 1992. Then once when I was kicked out from that area, I was in Croatia. And from Croatia, I got an opportunity to come to Canada. And from 1995 onwards, I am in Canada. Since coming to Canada, I had an opportunity, alhamdulillah, to study. So I studied, got my master's in education. My focus was on Muslim parents and parental engagement in Western educational institutions. And then I got my PhD from Simon Fraser University, again in the Department of Education, with focus on hermeneutics of Islamic formative principles and creation of Muslim Western cultures, faithful but reformed. It's a very challenging topic, but when I started in 2003, all what I spoke about, almost like reality, is happening today. So I was somehow visionary at the time that we would face some of these challenges. What I would like to share with you today is related to Hijrah. Who would tell me what is the Hijri year we are in today? 1436. Yes. Today could be maybe second or third of Muharram. And Hijrah is a season that is very unique in meaning and lessons. Unfortunately, Muslims read only literally historical perspective as far as Hijrah is concerned, or mostly they read so. We follow how Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam prepared for Hijrah, how he went out with Abu Bakr, how they were chased, how they were stuck in the Ghar al-Thawr, and how Abu Bakr got scared when mushriks approached the mouth of the cave, and how they came to Yathrib at that time, later on known Medina al-Munawwara, and how people were singing Tala al-Badru alayna. That's how we see Hijrah. We don't go deep into Hijrah. We don't analyze Hijrah, so to see the meanings of Hijrah for our own time. And there are many. If we look analytically into this notion of Hijrah, we will find out, subhanallah, that we can live Hijrah and meaning of Hijrah today here in Canada. And get full benefits of these lessons that we can take from Hijrah of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. What Hijrah means? Historically, it means movement of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam from Mecca to Medina, and his arrival in Medina on September 24th, 600, which year? 622. So September 24th, 622, Common Era, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam arrived in Yathrib. Interesting, this small city, when that was welcoming city for Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when Sahaba came in, many of them got sick. It was so filthy, so dirty city, that many of Sahaba got sick. Aisha radiallahu anha, she suggests that it was impossible to breathe of najasa that was around. Even though Medina is very rich in terms of water and possibilities of agriculture, not much was utilized. So when Muslims came to Medina, subhanallah, you'll find out almost, we can say, industrial revolution within the city. Now I'll talk about it, inshallah, just to give you a hint, some sort of abstract of what I will be talking about. So geographically or historically, it meant movement from Mecca to Medina. Linguistically, it means to separate yourself from something or someone or some sort of an exile. But there is another one that is important for us. It is figurative or metaphorical sense of Hijrah. And that means to separate yourself from conditions that are bad, or moving from the sphere of haram into the sphere of halal. And that's the reason why Prophet, peace be upon him, said in one of the hadith, Al-Muhajiru Man Hajara Manaha Allahu An. Real Muhajir, and I use this hadith basically to state the obvious, all Hijrah in today's world. What it should be. Al-Muhajiru من هجر ما نهى الله عنه. Real muhajir of our time is one who separates himself or herself from haram, from what is forbidden, from something what would not make God Almighty happy with us. For Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it meant removal from the jahili society, removal from the jahili mentality, and going into the sphere that would give him an opportunity or opportunities whereby he would be able to build, if we could say, first ever democratic society. And indeed, when we look through the history, we will be able to find out that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam established a society, or Medina, city, city, or we can say state, in which there was some sort of constitution. And there was very unique agreement among all people that was called Medina Charter. And if you Google, you'll find out more information on Medina Charter. You'll be very much impressed that in 7th century, a man of his stature has contributed so much to the future generation by establishing that small constitution that was called Medina Charter. So what I want, inshallah, then in this context to talk to you about is related to five meanings or lessons that we can extract from Hijrah. First one is proper understanding of kebed and tawakkul. That's number one. Proper understanding of kebed and tawakkul. Number two, maintaining one's Islamic identity. Number three, productivity and citizenship. And number four, productive leadership or servant ethical leadership of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So let us start, inshallah, with this first one, lesson on kebed and tawakkul. If you check out the beginnings of preparation for the hijrah, you'll find out that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not leave anything without planning. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam took everything into consideration, even though this is a man who can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who can raise hands and say, Ya Allah, I put trust in you as you promised. Defend me against these people who want to harm me and harm Muslims. Yet, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam plans A to Z. And only at the time when mushriks came at the mouth of Ghar al-Thawr, that cave, when Abu Bakr started panicking, only then he brings tawakkul. Only then he says to Abu Bakr, no worries, la tahzan, inna Allah ma'ana. You know, we have given all what we have been able to. We have done all what we have been able to do in human possibilities. Now at this point of time, we leave everything to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you would see how it went. When Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam started planning, first he planned to get out at night. Why? Because it's obvious. At night, there is less possibility that he would be seen. Number two, he planned route. He did not just say, let's go the shortest distance to Medina. Why? Because sometimes shortest could be the longest. So that was a zigzag, you know, way of going through many different roads so that they would get safe to their destination. Number three, what is interesting is he has hired a guide who happened to be a non-Muslim, mushrik actually. How could you get in, you know, and deal with a non-believer, mushrik? He got in with you know, in deal with him, and this guy trusted him. and took him from point A to point B without really revealing place, you know, of their stay. And then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also thought about food. You know, we do not know how many days we will be on this trip, so there should be somebody out there who would help us as far as food is concerned. So all of these, and there are actually 16 of these points mentioned in the seerah, all of these have been done by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a planning strategy to have successful hijrah. And of course, mushriks are following, and when they were at the mouth of cave, when Abu Bakr started panicking, that's a time when Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, tells him, no worries, no worries, Allah is with us. We have done all humanly possible, and now we put trust in God. And that is, my brothers, where we have to think about our own situation. I think we live in the best country in the world. You choose one and then let's go, I'll follow you. If there is anything like this, and proof for what I'm telling you is that you are here. You have been able to stay in your own country. I have been able to stay in Bosnia. No, and you know what? I will not go there as well. Why? Because whenever I go to Bosnia, I need a new vocation. I get so much disappointed. I get so much distracted. Corruption wherever you turn, and then you come to your own Canada, and you just feel comfortable in your own skin. And actually, to be honest, all of us, in a way, became better Muslims in Canada. I was culturally bound Muslim when I was in Bosnia. In Canada, I became conscious Muslim. I came to my senses. I realized if I don't help myself, nobody would. I don't have a backup system. I don't have hundreds of my cousins around myself. It's all about me. It's all about I. It's all about my family. And then, only then, I would be able to be part of the larger community. So message is very simple. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدْ. We have created human being into toil and struggle. You cannot just say, Ya Allah, give me. Ya Allah, help me. Ya أَيُّهَا آمَنُوا إِن تَنْصُرُوا اللَّهَ يَنْصُرُكُمْ وَيُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ. There is this, you know, this ayah very clearly indicates that Allah's help is conditional. It's not just, here you go. You can get it anytime you want. You and I have to work for that help. All you who believe, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, all you who have made a contract with God Almighty, in tansurullah, if you do support the cause of Allah, yansurukum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would help you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would aid you in your progress, in your growth. So here we do find out that there has to be some sort of a balance between kabad and tawakkul. We cannot just raise our hands and say, Ya Allah, help me. In Canada, my brothers, you are well aware, you know, Canadians, you know, do have image of Islam on the base of us and our behavior and our attitude. Indonesia would not be what it is if it was not, you know, attitude of Muslims. You know, Islam did not go there with a sword, as some people suggest. Islam came down there with an attitude of Muslims, akhlaq, you know, etiquettes of a good businessman. So that's how Islam actually captured hearts and minds of people in Indonesia. In Canada, we have a great opportunity. And I'm not talking here about conversion. Conversion is not in hands of us. I'm talking here about Canadians being sympathetic to our cause. Canadians being sympathetic to who we are. As you could see, you know, things could happen. Ottawa, Toronto 18. Things do happen. We could talk about conspiracy theories as much as we want. But reality is that I know people, I have dealt with people who do have some strange ideas. I'll give you a hint. In 2010, I came to one masjid in one of the cities in Ontario. And after Taraweeh, I sat with young... I like to sit with young people, you know. You feel young when you are with them. So these people started talking about, Canada and all what is happening. And one of them, particularly one of them, was very vocal, very smart, well-read, good English. And he was leading. You could see that he has a huge impact on the others. So what he said, I'm here for 8 years. I'm studying, and once when I finish, I'm out of this Kafir society. I'm out of this Kafir society. I have a chance to get my papers, but it's haram to get your papers. So my natural response would be, why, Echi? I paid to come to Canada. And you know what? With this passport, I'm very comfortable. Why should I not be? You know, when I go to Europe, if I have Bosnian passport, I'm telling you, that would be a disaster at every border. With Canadian passport, yes, sir, I'm through. No problems. Do I face some challenges? Certainly. If you Google my name, you'll find out that I've had a lot of problems with Harper's government. And I'm proud of it, because I knew that I had problems with Harper's government only because I said things that I was supposed to say, and somebody didn't like them. But nobody checked them out. Are they truth or not? So there are things that are out there and that are difficult. But when you talk about environment in which you and I can live our faith faithfully, this is the place. Try any other and you'll see. I've been in Australia, I've been in US, and I could tell you, not healthy at all. So understanding of kabad and tawakkul is very much important for us in this context.
Sorry, now, can you please define kabad and tawakkul?
Kabad is strive and struggle. Tawakkul is dependence on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Putting full trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm not saying that it doesn't have to be all the time from A to Z. It has to be. But we also have to contribute in the discourse. We cannot just say, I put, you know, it would be the same, like you get a huge course load at your university. And you know you have to do it. But at the end, you know, you didn't do anything and you just say, inshallah, Allah would help me. And then all of a sudden you get into your exam, you know what, you fail miserably. You see, but if you study and exert all your effort into it, inshallah, Allah is going to help you together with that. And you would, at the end of the day, you will get your desired intended marks. So that's number one. Number two, identity. Anybody of you who will tell me when the first traces of our presence in Canada are? When do they date? When Muslims were basically first seen in Canada? What is the population of Muslims with first, let's say, census? Anybody knows about our history in Canada? Anybody?
As far as I know, there's some natives. They were Muslims. Some natives.
Later on. I'm talking about Muslims before Confederation.
Around 1850, or between 1900.
Yes, 1871. Census suggests that we have had 13 Muslims. Yeah. 1871, before Confederation, before Canada. By 1981, we have had around 100,000 Muslims. Think about it. From 1981 onwards until today, we have 1.1 million Muslims. Most of Muslims or 90% of Muslims came in the last 35 years. We are very young as far over citizenship is concerned. We are very young. We are the youngest religious group, not just in terms of our coming, but the youngest religious groups in terms of our median age. What do you think? What is our median age? Median age, I think, put all Muslims together and cut through and see how much they are young, how much they are old. Christian community or all denominations are somewhere between 42 and 46. Jewish community is around 43. Any taker?
28, under 30.
Yeah, under 30. 28.1. We are very youthful. In some out of our schools, some out of our public schools, there are 50 to 60% Muslim kids. Yes? In some out of our public schools, there are 50 to 60% Muslim kids. So Muslims are very much present. And alhamdulillah, Orava is a very unique city with a lot of potential. People who work, you know, at government. I went to one presentation at Foreign Affairs. I was giving talk on integration of Canadian Muslims, and there were approximately 40, 50 policy makers. And when I entered that room, you cannot believe, I scanned the room, approximately 20 of them were Muslims. Approximately 20 of them were Muslims. So Muslims are very much, very much present. Their identity is a very unique identity. There are signs that are obvious that they are Muslim, but some of them don't have those signs. But when it comes down to the Islamic doctrine, Islamic principles, these people are very tough, very strong on. Islamic identity for us is one of the most important things to be defended here. As long as we live within the framework of our faith, respecting the basic formative principles, we are, alhamdulillah, good to go. I'm not talking about cultural identity or national identity. I'm talking about purely religious identity. That identity that helps you filters ideas, thoughts, behaviors, actions, that's what I talk about. If this is strong, everything else, inshallah, is gonna be strong. So when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam moved from Mecca to Medina, he moved from Mecca to Medina with the purpose of defending this identity. And when they came to Medina, they continued protecting this identity. And actually that identity grew. The same happens to us here. As I said, and I'm very, very serious in making this statement, many of us in Canada became better Muslims than we were back home. Many of us became much more conscious Muslims than we were back home. Back home, we had only one brand that we were thinking is the only brand. When we came to Canada, subhanAllah, you know, we saw different expressions of Islam. Now, there is a problem of how do we merge all these different expressions? How do we find that universal line between all of them and accept that universal line? I spoke about creation of Canadian Muslim culture in 1997. And I think we are heading towards it. We like it or not. That would be a reality. Otherwise, we will be having national masjids across Canada. And national masjids are not part of the discourse in Islam. You cannot have a national masjid. You cannot say this is my masjid and nobody can come here. In Toronto, there are such masajid, particularly catering only one particular group. They speak their language in that group. You go for Juma and you just sit. You don't understand anything. So what we are looking here for is basically, you know, we settled in Canada. Now, mode of communication is English or French. Not because of I or you, because of our kids, who will not be able to speak language where we came from. Definitely not effectively, proficiently, like we do.
So we have to focus a little bit there. That doesn't mean that we are not, please brothers, I will caution you. Don't think if kids don't eat biryani that they are not good Muslims. Or don't eat baklava that they are not good Muslims. No, I'm talking about more serious things. You see, I would rather my kids not get engaged in haram. Okay, I would rather my kids don't call themselves Mo or Joe. I would like them, when they are offered crack or weed, they say, excuse me, I don't do that stuff. Not because doctors told me it's not good, because I'm a Muslim. And I don't do that stuff because I'm a Muslim. Not many kids do have that stamina to say. Why? Because, you know, our community is not on that level yet, you know, to really teach kids to be proud, not arrogant. Proud Muslims, yes. To be skillful. Their self-esteem is through the roof. No, they are skillful, they're progressive, proactive. How many of our kids volunteer in schools, in hospitals? How many of our kids volunteer in libraries, in different camps? No many. That's where we have to put our kids. Get in. How many of our kids are, you know, in sports? I know, yes, but, you know, in very segregated, separated. We have to be part of it. As long as we, and wallahi, I'm not promoting emancipation, total emancipation. No, not at all. I'm promoting, you know, engagement, participation. That is basically on our terms. On our terms. As long as I don't get engaged in something haram, I'm in. Okay? So that's number two, identity. Number three, productivity and citizenship. Who will tell me where Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was born? Mecca. Where did he die?
Medina.
Does this tell you anything? Anything? He was born in Mecca. He moved to Medina. Even though he liberated Mecca, he's been able to stay. He moved back to Medina. He did not stop loving Mecca, but his job, his presence in Medina was so obvious, and he stayed there. You know, I tell Muslims, buy yourself a grave in Canada. You're not going anywhere. See, I came to Canada in 1995. I came 1995, and do you know what I said? Wallahi, these were my words. Inshallah, when I get my passport, I'm out of here. I got my passport. I'm still here. Why? If it is not good as it is. Of course, I will not be here, but it is good. Alhamdulillah. I'm not saying, you know, in Canada, if you came to Canada just to earn money, forget it. You'll not earn money. You'll earn and you'll spend, because everything is designed in such a way, doesn't matter how much you earn, you'll spend. There is a way how somebody will come and go through your wallet and you'll give it. But there are many other things that are part of our living that we really benefit from. Freedom. Freedom. Freedom of being who you are. That doesn't mean that we don't have some problems here and there. But tell me, in which Muslim, so-called Muslim country, you would be able to be free as you are here? Any? Can you tell me any Muslim country? And wallahi, I'm not trying to demean any Muslim. I wish that all so-called Muslim countries are more Muslim than they are. There is no such a place. Sorry, I'm really not trying to. I'm talking first about Bosnia. Canada is our Medina. Okay? As Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had Medina, we have our own Medina. When Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam moved from Mecca to Medina, he rolled up his sleeves and cleansed that city. Cleaned it and made it into, from Yathrib into Medina al-Munawwara. What does it mean? What is Medina al-Munawwara?
Showered by blessings.
City of light. So light. Lightened city, enlightened city. So that suggests that Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did some work out there. Analytically looking into his movement, it tells you that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did roll up his sleeves and did work. So in Canada, alhamdulillah, we cannot just say my rights, what about responsibilities? A Muslim is always between rights and responsibilities. That's what Muslim is all about. I have rights, but I have responsibilities. My wife has rights, but she has responsibilities too. I have rights, I have responsibilities too. As an individual, as a husband, as a wife, as a child, as a parent, as a citizen, that's how it works. So Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam basically showed us that when you move from one place to another, you just don't use it. You make it better. And if you don't like something in Canada, don't open up mouth and yell. You know, media likes when Muslims open up mouth. They take shoro and
don't use it.
Yeah. So what we need to do, we need, again, to roll up our sleeves and go and do work. You see, in Canada, anything what you disagree, you can democratically fight. Anything. And that's what Quran tells us. Udu'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah wal maw'idha al hasana wajadilhum billati hiya ahsan. You know, our engagement or discourse with them is with hikmah, wisdom, good advice, or if you disagree with them, disagree in the best possible manner. Facts, arguments, proofs. In Canada, when you bring arguments, proofs, I'm telling you, many people buy into it. But if you speak emotionally, nobody's going to buy into it. Okay, so this is we are talking about third, productivity and citizenship. There is something what I actually wrote a book. It's a little bit controversial topic. I don't like you to see the title. Some of you will get mad at me, as I already got an experience. So I'll just tell you it's a good book. And I would like you, before you open mouth to tell me about this book, anything, don't judge me on the basis of its title.
Title?
Yes. Don't judge me on the basis of its title. Because sometimes something has to be controversial to be read. And that's the reason why I wrote it. Okay. In this book, there is a chapter dealing with faithful citizenship. I call it social contract. When I came to Canada, I signed citizenship. It's called Ahd or Mithaq. It's an agreement. It's a contract. God Almighty says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, awfu bil'uqud. What does it mean? All you who believe, uphold your contracts. Meaning, any agreement that you made, uphold 100%. No deviations, no cutting corners, no cheating. If you do so, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, called these people treacherous people. Ayatul Munafiq, Thalatha. Idha Hadath, Idha Wa'ad, Wa Idha Tu'min, Khan. Idha Tu'min, Khan. A treacherous one. You cannot trust him. He's like a fish. You cannot hold him. You see, from this perspective, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was the most effective citizen because he did work in Medina, he kept Medina together, and he fought for Medina, even against his own people from Mecca. That tells you much. And if a Muslim, if a person who happened to be Muslim attacks Canada, it's my duty to stand against that person. I know it's a heavy statement.
Yes, it is a heavy statement.
Yeah, I'll tell you. Prophet peace be upon him, he said, "Unsur akhaka zaliman aw madhluma." You help your brother if it happened to be that he is a zalim or madhlum. A person who is doing injustice or towards whom injustice has been done. And Sahaba said, "Ya Rasulullah, yes, we understand person towards whom injustice has been done. Well, what about this? You know, who is doing an injustice? How could I help him?" He said, "What? Yes, take hold of his hand, stop him, prevent him." Okay. In this situation, where we had example this Ottawa case. Yeah, I know, and I don't like to get into politics because I'm not a politician. But I will tell you this is what I know. All these incidents that are happening are mostly happening because of socio-economic political conditions of a person, not because of faith. Not because of faith. Actually, you know what I suggested, that if there is anybody radicalized, the best way to de-radicalize them is through Islam, again. Proper understanding of faith. And alhamdulillah, this book is some sort of an antidote to such an approach, negative approach. Why? Because it tells you about who you are. It tells you, be proud of yourself. It tells you that having strong Muslim identity would do nothing but help you to be a good Canadian citizen. So being a good Muslim naturally translates into being a good Canadian citizen. It tells you then that integration is the only way of dealing here. There is no assimilation. I don't want to be assimilated. I don't want to be like others. Different sometimes, especially in Islamic terms, means being better. Different means being better. If I'm different from some people, it doesn't mean that I'm worse than them. It means only that I'm different. In Islamic terms, specifically when it comes to things that are related to strongly forbidden aspect of life, I am quite well. I'm comfortable. I'm well. So, looking then from that perspective, integration is the only way, not exclusion or assimilation. Exclusion doesn't help anybody. And last point, inshallah, that I want to share with you is related to the character of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We need leaders who are wise, who are honest, and who are people's leaders, who are not leaders for themselves. We don't need people. We don't need leaders who are bossing people. We need leaders who are serving people. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, "Sayyidul qawmi khadimuhum." Leader of people is their servant. He's in service of people. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was departing from Mecca to Medina, he left Ali radiallahu anhu. What did he leave him for?
Amanah.
Oh, cool. Can you explain what has happened? No, please, can you? He left him. He said he left him for the Amanah. What is Amanah?
Something you have someone for safekeeping.
Yes. Why people have given it to him? They didn't like him.
It's the character of the person, really. No matter what, I mean, in Australia, a judge was blamed for being abusing or molesting children. And at the same time, because of his being a very good judge, the friends still said, "Well, he did that, but he's a very good judge. Or he has this very good characteristic."
Of being fair.
Yes. And that's why he was being applauded at the same time.
Yes.
He was being blamed.
Yes.
So if you take a look at it, human nature comes into action here. That no matter what you do, even though if I may disagree with your point, whatever you lecture, but I might still say, but Sheikh Zijad is a very good speaker.
Jazakallah khair.
So, yes. Of course, they did disagree with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Yes.
But on the other hand, they did see that this person is a very trustworthy person.
Yes.
And even if we did give him our lives, he will give it back to us.
You see, one thing that is interesting here, brothers, and subhanAllah, this is what captures hearts of people and minds of people. Look at this person, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You see, we don't really take much of we don't look analytically into his life. Look at him. Ma khujira Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam bayna al-imrayn ila ikhtara aysarahuma ma lam yakun ithma. Subhanallah. Whenever Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given two alternatives, he would always choose easier one under one condition, that it was not a sin. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very pragmatic in dealing with people. You remember Treaty of Hudaybiyah. He's sitting with mushriks and he's dictating from Muhammad, messenger of God, to the other party. And they say, excuse us? You are not, for us, you are not messenger of God. Just scrap it off and put from Muhammad, son of Abdullah, to the other party. And Sahaba jump up. How can you abuse Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And he tells them, no. From Muhammad, son of Abdullah, to the other part. Look at this vision. See, Muslims would fight. And that was not priority for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew when to choose battle and when to choose the war. He did not get into every, you know. Today Muslims, subhanAllah, for them, you know, for some of them, everything becomes haram. You know, even breathing Canadian air becomes haram, you know. Everything. No, we should not look into Islam that way. You know, there is an obvious haram and there is gray area. You know, we can always negotiate, you know, but not everybody could, you know. We easily judge people. We measure faith of people just easily like that. And that's not our field. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us many lessons that we can learn. Just think about one lesson. Think about it. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam enters Battle of Badr. They capture around 70 mushriks. What do they do to them? What do they do to them? There is an opinion, khalas. And then there is an opinion, don't do that to them. Let's go, each one of them would teach 10 Muslims. That was first ever school in Muslim history in which all students were Muslims and all teachers were non-Muslims, mushriks. So why don't we read history this way? And we can. And there is no fear in reading it. And subhanAllah, if you read, you know, some of the scholars, I'm talking about classical Muslim scholars as well as, and I'm talking about, you know, Ibn Taymiyyah as well. I'm talking Ibn Rajab. I'm talking about, you know, Abu Hanifa. I'm talking about Al-Albani as a modern Muslim scholar, you know, in North America. These people are suggesting very clear indication of how we can maneuver as far as this knowledge is concerned. So what I'm aiming to tell you is this. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had a quality. He was like a bank of the time. He was like a bank of the time. People had their valuable stuff. They didn't trust anybody. They trusted Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though they didn't like him. They didn't like his message. But they trusted him. So they would leave this stuff with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when he was departing, imagine, they have given me all this hard time. They want to kill me. And I have all their belongings. I can carry it with me. That's what regular human being would be thinking. Now I'm going to punish you guys. put it in a bag, take two camels, and run away with this. But not Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He leaves Ali radiallahu anhu to return those, you know, belongings, amanat, to their righteous owners. So putting that, all of these into context, alhamdulillah, we, as I said at the very beginning, we enjoy a really beautiful country. I'm not saying, as somebody said, shape up or ship out. I'm not saying it. I'm saying we have to understand our faith within this context and adapt some of the matters. And I'm not saying that we have to adopt prayer and make it four or five, four or six or three. I'm saying there are some issues which we are able to adopt. And I know I'm a little bit controversial. I'm challenging things. But believe me, I'm with my community A to Z. And I know when to not say something, and I know when to say something, simply because I do understand my community, and I wish well to my community. Some brothers would not maybe understand me, you know, as I intend to project myself. But you know what? It's good to challenge one another, and I give you an opportunity to challenge me. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum.
Brother Ziyad, you're talking about integration, and as young Muslims or young newcomers to Canada as Muslims and trying to bring up kids here, we find integration at early stage a little bit dangerous for our kids. And how do you tackle being in this society and trying to integrate to a limit and saving your Islam rather than your, you know, national identity or anything like that?
Okay. You see, this integration, term integration, is very controversial as well. In France, example, integration means assimilation. In Canada, it means a two-way street. As I integrate, Canadian system adapts as well. So in Canada, it's a little bit different. I'll tell you how we can do with our kids. Example, how many of you sit on parents' bodies of the schools where your kids attend? How many of you sit? You sit?
Before.
How many of you sit currently on the parents' committee of the schools in which your kids attend? You do sit? Alhamdulillah. Every school should have a Muslim sitting on this board. I'm not saying that we have to, you know, snoop. No. I'm saying that we have to go there intentionally to contribute to ourselves and others. That's one of the ways of doing it. Number two, when it comes to, Imam's job, Imams could do amazing things with community, but Imam has to be community centric, person, community, society, person, family, community, society centric person. If you are looking for an Imam, please take my advice. And again, I will be very controversial, as I am. Okay. I'll be very honest and straightforward. Take an Imam who only doesn't have knowledge, who has social aptitude, and would be able to deal with everybody without judging anybody, but rather helping everybody to go towards the desired goal, even though if we are all different. You know, library of knowledge that cannot be applied in the context in which we live doesn't help. Generations would go through and they will get lost. And you cannot afford it to yourself, neither I. And wallahi, I do have utmost respect for scholars. Utmost respect. And I don't consider myself Imam. I'm just a brother. who happened to get this position. Maybe I'm divorced. God knows. So what I'm saying that imams do carry huge potential, but huge responsibility too. So what I'm asking you, example, I'll give you a hint. I am involved in 6 Ottawa public schools regularly. I do give sensitive training to teachers, because we do have in each school, we do have huge number of Muslims. And teachers want to know what is going on, how things are operating. Alhamdulillah, my book right now became a book that is read by all students who attend class on religions. So I'm called on a regular basis to the book club discussions. See? My book, alhamdulillah, is also in the library. Not many books would be in the library, especially if it is written from the person from inside the community, a person who belongs to the community. You go to the library and you'll find out all Orientalists or critics of Islam. You'll not find a book written by a Muslim that is sensible, that is respectful of tradition. Go down to the library and check it out. This book, alhamdulillah, finished on the shelves of libraries. You have an opportunity, inshallah, tonight maybe to sponsor some book and take them to the library. Say, we want this book to be in the library. And you can tell them, Ottawa Public Library has it, and we will give you, inshallah, opportunities to, you know, to put this book out there. And donate the books. I donated maybe 1,000 of these books. All MPs got them. 310 of them on Parliament Hill. All senators got them. 105 of them. All trustees in Ottawa got them. RCMP, CCs, Ottawa Police, all of them got them for free. So we can do that job. And you know what they say? We need more. So these are some of the ways how we are able to help that solid integration. It means I'm going to help you to understand me, just as you would help me understand you. It's not that I have to give up on anything. Believe me, in Canada, people are not asking you to give up on stuff. I've seen, you know what is, wallahi, I'll give you this hint. In DND, Department of National Defense, Muslims got prayer area for Juma prayer and regular daily prayers. They even didn't ask. Why? Because they have exceptional people in that department. The most effective people in the department. Muslims are the best in every single area, from IT to management levels, the best. Why they should not give them? When you perform well, nobody's going to question you, what about your half an hour that you are going out? People tell you, I hear that you're doing that prayer on Fridays. And they will give you. But there are some people who come to me and tell me, Imam Ziyar, can you write me a reference letter? Because these guys don't allow me Juma prayer. My first question to them is, do you have any problem with them? Are you a good worker? Or you are like 50-50? Shwaye. Yeah. And when I talk to the management, first thing that management would tell me that these people are not good. They are not honest. And we don't want them to trick us all the time. So when we perform as we are supposed to perform, I'm telling you, everybody would be opening arms. Of course, there are some bigots. It's normal. In every tradition, there are some. But you cannot generalize and say Canadians are not. They are good, I'm telling you. And you know it. You have seen it. Just as I have seen. Jazakallah khair.
More Sheikh Ziyad of children.
Children.
I'll give you an example for me.
Go on.
Kids go to public school and they ask me to have a play date with a family. So I don't let them do that. And if I do, it has to be a family that I really know. And so how can we protect our children?
Play date, can you explain?
Play date is when they go spend 2 hours together, play video games.
With whom?
With non-Muslims.
Do you know them?
Yeah, I know the family. But of course, they are different from us.
Aren't you able to make an agreement with the family?
Yeah, the one that I let them know is that they don't watch TV.
Of course.
They don't eat.
And I'm telling you, they'll respect your opinion.
They do, yes.
What you tell them, look, I do have certain principles in my life. Just when your kids come to my place, there are certain principles in your life. We don't eat this, we don't do that, we don't watch this, we don't use language, and so on and so on and so on. And so on. You put a strategy, and I'm telling you, all of that would be respected. There are some of the ways of how you put... There is no way that you can exclude your kids from the evil. There is no way.
Yeah.
But what you and I can do, we can guide our kids. Brothers, I let me just give you a hint. If your kids stop asking you questions, don't think everything is well. If they stop asking you questions, they're asking somebody else. And that somebody else maybe is not of your taste. That somebody else is maybe not of your thinking. So what I'm telling you, kids in Canadian society, if parents do not have patience, don't have carem for the kids. Kids know how to go cut corners. You know, kids don't need us as far as information is concerned. It's all under their fingers. And if you and I don't have trust with our kids, and they cannot trust us, and we cannot trust them, we are in big problem. So what I'm suggesting is that there are always things where we can adjust. There are things where we cannot adjust. Example. Let's say kids want to go sleep over. Ooh, big stuff. We have to. There are rules, in the family that must be abide by. You know, you're a parent. You have to take care of your kids, and you have to put some, you know, benchmarks as far as, you know, going out, staying. You know, teenagers when they hit 15, 16, an independent, especially if they have bigger muscles. Walaikum salam. They want to be independent. So what do you do at that point of time? You have to balance. I went to one school. They didn't know that I'm a Muslim. They didn't, there are some people who also have small beards and sporty beards and so on. So I entered. They were thinking that I'm a counselor. So I asked him, and I knew there may be 60% of them Muslims. I asked them this. I said, how many of you date? I'm telling you, it was like mass. How many of you drink?
You're talking about teenage people.
Teenage people. Okay. Among them, many Muslims.
Yeah, 60% you said.
Yes. Brothers. How many of you trick parents in? Many. And I'm not saying, that, I'm not talking about your kids. Maybe your kids, alhamdulillah, are the best kids. I'm saying that it is prevalent. It is there. Kids do have friends. What we need to do is we need to be cool parents. We need to be good friends. We need to be there when they need us. You know what? The best thing that you and I can give to our kids. There are two things that you can give to your kids. Best thing that you can give to them is your constructive time. Meaning, not just that you sit with them and you watch, you know, your back home, you know, news, and your kid is going like crazy on games. That's not constructive time. Constructive time is that you engage, roll up sleeve, and engage with your kid, A to Z. You be part of that game with him or her. And number two, good thing that you can do for your kid, be nice to his or her mom. Does it make sense?
That's a tough one.
Yes.
Can I just suggest that because given the time frame we have here,
yes,
we'll give a chance, you know, to go from right to left if they have any question and trying to answer it briefly so that we could catch as many questions as we can.
Yes. And I also have to go.
I know you have to. And so I'll ask you just to start just briefly. And youth is a big step here in Canada, in BC, in Victoria, anywhere you go.
Youth,
yeah.
Yes.
This is like they are today's youth, tomorrow the new leaders of this community everywhere. So is there any advice you could share with us?
I would, inshallah. I'll be here for Juma prayer on 7th of November. And I'll speak about building strong families and building strong community. I'll focus, actually, from an Islamic perspective on family dynamics and community. What it means to have a strong Muslim community in Canada. What are the ingredients of building this strong community? Of course, before that, building strong individual and strong family. What I think there are a few guiding principles that we have to have in upbringing of our kids. One thing that I think is essential to have one standard in the family, and that is God's standard, not mine, not mom's. And we cannot switch from, you know, God's standard to my standard. I said so. Kids would ask you, what about what God Almighty did ask? You see, a father or mother cannot lie and then say, kids, don't lie. You see, father and mother cannot scream and yell at one another and holding one another for the next and then tell kids, don't fight. It just doesn't make sense. It's a double standard. All right. Some of these things are very much important, and we have to be honest. It happens in our families. You know, Muslims are hot. They easily get frustrated. Am I right?
Yep, exactly right.
But it's more like cultural Muslims than Muslims.
Yeah, I know. But I'm talking about all of us in general. You know, when I came to Richmond Masjid first time, first week, I came in front of the masjid and brothers from a particular culture were yelling at one another. I said, excuse me, brothers, don't. I said, what, we are just talking. We're just talking, you know, this is how we deal. I said, this is so scary if you talk like this. I said, this is how it goes with us, you know. We cannot go without it. So, you know, we are emotionally sometimes driven and we should not do that. There is another principle that is important. Communication with our kids is essential. There are four types of communication, and specifically with family, and specifically even more with our kids. There is one that is called assertive. There is one called aggressive. There is third one called passive. And there is fourth one called combination, passive and aggressive. Which one do you use?
Assertive.
What does it mean? What assertive? What do we understand when we say assertive?
We're communicating it properly, but not becoming very arrogant.
Yes. It is that is adaptable to the age, specifically with kids. You cannot talk to your kid who is 6 and the other kid who is 12 the same way, because concepts are not understood the same way, and there is no comprehension of the situation or this concept the same way. So communication with your kids is very essential. Actually, communication with everybody, including your boss, is very essential. So the only one type of communication that really works and brings fruits is assertive. Aggressive doesn't work. Aggressive produces nothing else than aggression from the other side. Passive, not good. If your kid is just keeping quiet and you say what you want to say and you say, I talked to him today. You know, you didn't talk to him. You yell at him. Communication is when we talk. Dialogue. It's not a monologue. So Communication is very essential with our kids. As I said, if we do not communicate with them, you know what? Every school has a counselor. You know, and I'm not threatening. I'm saying, wallahi, every school has a counselor. When they notice that kid is not within the, normal framework of behavior, they do talk. Maybe there is a problem in the family, and specifically today, you know. Oh, your father wants you to have this or to wear this or not that. And then, they frame it that way. And then we can put ourselves in trouble. Yes, Akhi.
You mentioned that you have been in a Richmond Mosque, which I'm aware of, right? For about 11 years.
Yes.
And you mentioned in your talk that Imam should go outside, which is taking the mosque.
Yes.
I would like to know from you, how many times have you reached, and what did you do, and how did you do?
In Richmond, alhamdulillah, Richmond was the first place that I have enjoyed to be an imam in Canada. In almost freely, I have, since they didn't have job description except go and pray five daily prayers, Juma, Taraweeh, Janazah, that's it. Yes. So I had to design my own job description in terms of social servicing. I'm such a type of an imam, and this is not praise. God, wala tuzakku anfusakum. I'm just telling you for your own reference. My job description today has four areas. First one is maintenance of the masjid. Meaning, I have to find funds for the masjid. Okay? I have to take ownership as an imam to help board maintain the masjid. And all what I do has to be, and I'll come inshallah, this is only one. All what I do has to be measurable. Not just, I do it. Have you done it? What you have produced with what you are doing? Can I see it? Can I measure it? Point A to point B. That's one thing. Another thing is my activities in the masjid, from prayers. I am not obliged to be every prayer because I can be here and there. I do have people who help me with daily prayers. But I have to be there for Fajr, and I have to be there for Maghrib and Isha, 5 days. And I have to provide servicing in terms of, I do have example, Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday, I have 4 to 8 appointments with community. And I am a marriage officer, I'm a marriage counselor, I'm a youth mentor, I work with family services, basically anything that goes to let's say, a young boy got in trouble with police. They get in touch with me, and I do mentor that boy. I give him servicing, I do provide, you know, time for him. He stays with me, I do mentorship, and then I give him, you know, certificate that he has gone with me through this program, and then, you know, he doesn't go, let's say, to the court, and he's, you know, any trouble from him is removed. So these are some of the things that I do for the community during that period of time. So I do maintenance of the masjid. I do basic Islamic activities as far as prayer and as far as servicing is concerned. Family servicing is one of the largest file that I have. I wish that I have a full Muslim counselor with me. And you know what? Very soon, we would need even more. As I told somebody, approximately 35% to 38% of Muslims go through divorce in Canada or North America. That's a huge one. Think about it. 3.8 out of 10. People so easily get out of marriage. Thanks God that in Canada, if you want to get divorced, you have to wait for a year. You cannot get divorce paper. Very Islamic. You know, you cannot just go and say, talaq, 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 done, finished. No, it doesn't work that way. When people come to me and tell me, we want divorce, I tell them, go to the court and ask from them, once when you finish, come to me. It's a good cooling period for them. Marriage is not a joke. You get into marriage, you don't get into marriage just because of this or that. You see, you put a lot of people in trouble. And, of course, there, abghadul halal ila al-talaq, you know, it's obvious that marriage sometimes could become toxic. So in that situation, you can even suggest, if you see that both parties, there is no way, that it smells. When it smells, bury it. It doesn't work. So you can even help them to go easier through divorce, through the government. Make them agree, share, doesn't share, go through to the court and inshallah it goes easier. But if you see that there is a possibility, my job is to fight for this marriage. And I do. And that's one of the responsibilities of Imam here. You see, back home, just give me, then inshallah you will ask. Back home, we have had whole system behind us to support us in marriage. Am I right? Aunties, uncles, cousins, whole, you know, it's a net of support. Here we don't have. Even our communities don't give that service. Therefore, we have started the Alhamdulillah program that supports. I do have matchmaking program for young boys and girls who are not married. I do have seniors program. I have around 60 seniors in my community. Believe me, they enjoy like kids. First time they are meeting other Muslim seniors. They've been lonely.
Problem here.
Masjid, you know, we are getting from that, you know, generation who came here early, let's say, you know, 60, 70, 80. Right now, they're older people. So they need a little bit of servicing. And wallahi, مَنْ لَمْ يَرْحَمْ صَغِيرَنَا وَلَمْ يَعْرِفْ حَقَّ كَبِيرِنَا فَلَيْسَ مِنَّا. If you do not know their rights at their old age, we do not belong to this ummah. We are not good part of this ummah. And these services are very much important. And inshallah, I will talk to your leadership about these programs. Anything could be established with so little money. You just need committed people. Committed people. Yes, Akhi.
I just had a question about the hadith you mentioned. Are you sure that is an authentic hadith? Just asking because I've looked into this before.
It's good message. Okay. Yes, I know. Look, I would not go into details. Sometimes getting into details, we often detract from the, you know. I'm not muhaddith. I don't claim that I'm one. I think sometimes using a hadith that do carry weight in terms of application, scholars have very clearly indicated we can.
But in this case, I mean, you do have to specify the strength of the hadith.
I didn't specify.
No, I'm saying if you do, I mean, from what I know, if you want to use a hadith that is not authentic, then you have to mention that. And the second point is...
This is not da'if hadith.
Sorry, and the second point is, when you say that you want to use them for their benefit, this hadith actually has no fadail a'mal or anything like that. It's talking about what Allah likes and does not like. That's why I think it's serious. But anyway, Jazakallah khair. I just wanted to mention that.
Jazakallah khair, akhi.
Leave it next.
Is there? Doesn't look like.
You're trying.
I have a question. If you don't have time for one last question, I can only ask for one.
Please go. You're just waiting for the lineup.
Yeah. Go on, akhi.
Yeah, just a quick question. So, from what I've gathered throughout the entire speech, there are two scenarios that pretty much the Muslim community in Canada are facing. One, that we have the internal differences between the different sort of Muslim groups that we have in Canada who are essentially coexisting. And the other one is having some sort of an outreach, some sort of a plan in order to contribute to the society that you're living in. So what I have not been able to get from the speech was that what would be the prescribed way, or if there are any sort of prescriptions to treat both of these situations. I mean, in terms of the internal differences, how would you reckon that you can reconcile those issues that exist between the Muslim communities? And then in terms of the outreach, what could be done in order to contribute more to the society that you're living in?
Cool. See, it's very much important that we have action items in any discussion. And certainly, as far as internal challenges that we have, there are many. From linguistical, to geographical, to cultural, to political, to national, to interpretational. So we are, you know, we do get one of the personal advice that I would give to my brothers and sisters in Canadian society is we have to work on presenting universal picture of Islam, not cultural. Meaning that we have to know a little bit more. I'm not saying that all of us have to be scholars, but we have to know a little bit about Islam. You see, I do have a very simple approach to understanding Islam, specifically for young people. I always ask them, okay, what is the first word that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Read. There is a reason why it was done. Why it was not believe or pray? There is a reason. See, reading produces learning. Learning produces knowledge. Knowledge produces understanding. Only when you understand, you would be able to apply. Without understanding, there is no application. So, read so that you may learn. Learn so that you may know. Know so that you may understand. And once when you understand, then there is an obligation on you to apply it. My sense is that Canadian Muslim community is, at this point of time, struggling with settlement process. We are not settled yet. Many of us still think, oh, should I go back? Or one foot is up in the air waiting to depart, and another one is down on Canadian soil. Brothers, both feet. And that would be some sort of assurance that, inshallah, we will do things, good things for ourselves and the society. Second thing that I would also suggest as my personal advice, I've lived with Muslim community, you know, for almost 35 years, from being junior imam in Bosnia to being junior imam in Canada and now senior imam in Canada. And I could tell you that we need centers where people would come and have activities that would help them feel comfortable. Alhamdulillah, masjid, school. But we need centers. We need, Islam is beyond masjid. Real application of Islam is beyond the doors of the masjid. Ask kids and they will tell you. Real application of our faith is not in the masjid. It's easy to be a Muslim in the masjid. But once when you kick out the door, when you're down there on the street, when you are in your house, when you are in your work, that when you are dealing with your teenager, when smoke is coming through your ear, that's a time when we present ourselves as true, you know, Muslims. Third thing that I could tell you, we need to deal as Muslims, and we need to work on hard, is prioritize our priorities. What is priority? Hilal sighting is priority? That's all? That's all what Islam is all about for us Canadian Muslims? The biggest thing that we have on our agenda? And still we cannot agree on it. And we will never agree on it. You know, now, we do have two types of or two alternatives when we are looking into moon sighting, ittihad or ikhtilaf. Now we have five of them in Canada. We have Saudi, we have national, we have calculations, we have ikhtilaf, and we have ittihad. So five of them. And believe me, all of them are applicable. I mean, all of them are applied in Canada. There are people who follow Saudi, and doesn't matter what has been seen, they say, we follow Saudi and doesn't matter. There are people who say, no, local. And we tell them, what is local?
Our street.
Our city, our province, our Canada, North America. What is local? Global. What is global? Timbuktu? So Muslims don't want to accept, you know. And then there is another one. They say, oh, you see, Shahid, maybe he's not qualified. And we go into it day and night, and we go into it every month, you know, of Ramadan and Eid. And so these are some of the things that we are facing. We have to prioritize our priorities. And I think one of the first priorities is, A, how to help our kids maintain their Islamic identity in this part of the world. And that means resources, material and human resources must be directed out there. Number two priority is how to engage our kids with the larger society. How to engage them. You see, question of, and I pointed out on a few things. We have to be with our kids. We have to guide them. A to that. Z, when it comes to their integration into the society. Another thing that we need to get engaged is politics.
That's a good point.
Oh, yeah. You know, Muslims have to get engaged in politics. Some of you would... We have to be part of it. Why? I don't want somebody to make policies for me. I want to be part of the process. You know, Ali Izetbegovic, may Allah give him Jannah. He said, he defined politics, this is the best definition that you would ever hear. He said, politics is like sewage system. You need it, but it smells bad. You know, it's like sewage system. See, you need it, but it smells. So what you need to do, basically, you need to find like-minded people and ask them for support and support them. I will not support only Muslims. I'll support good Muslims into politics. I'll not support dishonest Muslims. I would rather support other who is honest than a Muslim who is dishonest. Make sense? So this is another area where we need to engage. And please, if you know somebody, and I know some of you may be thinking, Brother Zia, what are you talking about politics? We should not be getting, it's haram. That's not true. That's not true. You know, yes, we are living, this is a secular society. You know, but there are possibilities, inshallah, that we can make an impact, positive impact. And I hope, inshallah, we will do so. Another area where we need to work hard, to be more inclusive. More inclusive. We have to take care of our brothers, we have to take care of our sisters, we have to take care of our children, we have to take care of our neighbors. See, our neighbors, if you look into Islam, subhanAllah, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, talked about it, that he was thinking how Malik Jibrail was coming so much and suggesting neighbor, that he was thinking that neighbor would be able to inherit a neighbor. How many of us say, hello, good morning, to our neighbor? Or we just go like... Externally, we do have some challenges. But external challenges are nothing as compared to internal challenges. I can deal with any external challenge as long as I deal with my internal challenges. Once when I'm fit, when I'm built, when I'm strong, I can face any external challenge. Islamophobia, what is it? No big deal. I can deal with it. As long as I know that I have my community strong. That's not a big deal. Media, not big deal for me. Not big deal for anybody if you have strong community that knows how to deal with it. Wisdom, not emotions. Okay? Wisdom, not emotions. So there are many of them. Actually, I have written article, well-researched article, on internal and external challenges faced by Canadian Muslims. And inshallah, if you would like to read it, it's a very good article actually. Many people have said, I'm not saying, you know, This book is also suggesting a few of the things that maybe you can look at as a guiding force. What I'm suggesting, inshallah, please, you don't have to get the book. No, until somebody reads, you can read and suggest to brothers and sisters that, you know, most of them of the people in Ottawa have got this book. I got a few critiques, you know, negative, but 98 to 99% of people said we need these books. This book you can easily give to a non-Muslim friend, and you will not have, you know, people going like this. What are these guys talking about? Why? Because I made sure that things are done in a way that they understand well of what I'm talking about. I'm not bragging, but I'm not also not going under the skin. I'm not trying to preach. This is a very socially acceptable, politically acceptable book that could be shared with all friends. It's a modern approach to da'wah, to say.
The headline is very good. If I were to give it to someone understanding Islam, they would say, oh, another Muslim giving this book.
Yes, yes, yes.
Canadian Islam would be a different approach.
Yes. I gave this, actually, I got sponsorship from a brother from Vancouver, 100 books for one Muslim school in Ontario. He said, I wanted to give this to a Muslim school, grade 10, 11, and 12. So I went to the school, I took two packages with me, and I told principal, I have 100 books for you. He said, I cannot share it with my students.
Can I get a chance to get this book as a gift?
Yes. No problem, inshallah.
The reason for not giving...
No, what has happened? I told him, no problem. Alhamdulillah. Yeah, I took the book.
I have a question.
Just let me finish. I took the book, I put it in my bag, and I left. I told him, inshallah, you will need me. So I left. In 3 days, he called me, he said, I read your book, and I think I understood what you wanted to say. Please, can you bring it? So I went there, and alhamdulillah, I spoke to the students, and students read it. And teacher of these students told me that this is the only book, Muslim book, that students have read it ever. So you see, you cannot, as I said, you don't judge book on the basis of its cover. Yes, sir.
So just out of curiosity, I want to ask one thing. You said a few times, actually, about your books,
yes,
something controversial. And you said also your of what you offer, something controversial,
yes,
right?
People
so
say.
People say, yeah.
Yes.
People say controversial. So what kind of controversial thing?
I don't know.
No. If something controversial
about you
or your book, then...
You see, what people say is controversial is the way how I maybe express it. The way I challenge some of the things.
Yeah.
I don't keep quiet on some of the things. I do talk about them. Mm-hmm. I don't put stuff under the carpet, and when it starts smelling, guys, you know,
yeah.
I do talk about it.
Okay.
So controversial, I don't get, I don't have controversy in matters that are obvious.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't want to engage there because it's not my field. I will not feel comfortable with it. So example, where I'm very heavy is engagement of Muslim women in the community. I do suggest that Muslim sisters must be part. Of course, there is a respect. There has to be, but they have to get engaged. Why? Because if they don't get engaged, they will not know what is going on. Of course. Jazakumullah khairah.
One comment, if you don't mind, because I'm running the school here in the Islamic and Arabic school in Victoria. And just to add to what Brother Ziyad is saying, we have a lot of halaqas for the elderly, and you know, we heard it before and we're just hearing it again. But the youth, they don't know much. And we're not putting an effort as Muslims. If you have knowledge, if you have anything that you could share with them, especially if you're younger, and you could understand what they're living through and how they see things. Because for me, who came a long time ago, maybe I don't see as hard as I try to, where they come from. However, the youth here needs you guys. Wallahi, because I'm involved with about sixty to seventy students.
Can you get something else? MashaAllah.
There's a need for especially youth to come and talk to them. Don't ignore this. This is a responsibility. It's like, forget about da'wah to non-Muslims. Come make da'wah to the youth. The youth are in real need. We see a lot of problems. We see a lot of them that don't understand history. They don't understand what they're supposed to do when they're stuck in a situation. They're not so as the person who's running the school, please come and approach me and try to give something to the youth. Wallahi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask all of you. If you have the ability to give something, just ask me, say, can I come for half an hour on Friday or half an hour on Sunday, and we'll give it to you. Try to come and contribute. We're focusing a lot more on the reading, how to get them good readers and stuff like that. But we need people's help to get involved in this school and help the youth.
Is he going to be with us for the next few weeks?
No. You know what? I would
like to hire him as an imam.
No. Could I suggest this? Inshallah. I think you do have a lot of potential here. Okay, use your potential. Brothers, wallahi, there is no better charity than to give your skills, your time to the community. If you are good in Quran, in Hadith, if you are good in social skills, if you are good in with young people, you know what our kids need? They need 10 minutes of Quran and Hadith and 90 minutes of communication, discussion. Wallahi, they will learn from those 90 minutes much more about Islam that they will learn only by memorizing. Yes, it has to be part of the discussion, but they need somebody to guide them, you know. They need somebody, when asked questions, you know, to respond in a way that would help them, inshallah, manage through all those challenges that they are facing.
Can we take the last question?
Yes.
Just a general question. You told that you're been here for like 20 years, almost 20 years.
Yes.
Back to politics. If I was to ask you, who would you vote? Which party in Canada would you vote for?
I am a guy who votes not on the basis of party, except if it is strategic. Okay. I was in politics. So I was the first Muslim who ever has been lobbyist on parliament here. So I would, Justin Trudeau is, even though he has mistakes, he is the best. You see, people say, you know, if you have two evils, you choose the lesser evil. For me, he's a promising star that acknowledges our presence in Canada and that has ideas that could make this country a good country. Sometimes I do vote for NDP if that person is really somebody who is an example. Paul Doer is one of the top guys in NDP. He's Ottawa Centre. Why should I not vote for him if I'm in Ottawa Centre? He's an amazing guy who has done so much for Canadians, for Canada, as well as for Muslims or anybody else. So when it comes to voting, what you need to do, you know, if it is a strategic voting, then you have to agree on a person, even if you don't like him. If it is a strategic voting, if there is an opportunity to win or lose on larger scale, then you have to be strategic. Okay, but if it is not, then vote for somebody who really brings challenge and good stuff into the community. Welcome.
Zain, if you want to ask him in Bosnia, you could ask him too.
I would like just to say thank you very much. Hvala vam puno što ste došli, što ste nam znanje toliko dali i nadamo se da ćemo se opet vidjeti i nadamo se da ćete biti ovdje kod nas uvijek. Hvala vam puno i vidimo se opet.
You see, he's speaking better Bosnian than I am. Mula ya salli wa sallim daiman abadan ala habibi.
عليك خير الخلق كلهم.
مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم.
محمد أشرف الأعراب والعجم.
محمد أشرف الأعراب والعجم.
ها محمد خير من يمشي على قدمي.
مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم.
محمد تاج رسل الله قاطبة.
محمد تاج رسل الله قاطبة.
محمد صاحب الإحسان يا